his part as a long gray shape appears, its bulk a swelling silhouette in the growing light of day. This is a nuclear-powered and armed submarine, a product of man's seemingly infinite capacity to create instruments of destruction. This submarine has no other purpose than to destroy. It is the perfect weapon, silently and secretly cruising the dark depths of the ocean, capable of a terrifying response should the unthinkable, a nuclear strike, occur. The submarine submerges again to continue its lone vigil, stealthy, menacing, the ultimate killer. For centuries, in man's relentless quest to understand and conquer his environment, there was no more tantalizing goal than the mastery of the undersea world. But the path would be long and strewn with the fanciful, the fantastic, the futile, and the fatal. As early pioneers sought the secret of motion in the deep, they experimented with numerous propulsion schemes, hand-powered, treadmills, compressed air, and the most dangerous of all, steam. But only with the technology of the Industrial Revolution would the elusive dream become reality. Tenacious Irish-American John Holland earned the title Father of the Submarine. After leaving Ireland, he settled in Paterson, New Jersey in 1873. There, he built his first sub, the Fenian Ram, with funding from the Irish Fenian Society, who hoped to use it against the British. In 1900, a skeptical U.S. Navy took delivery of his small undersea craft, called simply the Holland. Their purchase was the result of 25 years of research, disappointment, and rejection. Though they didn't know it, the Holland was the first unqualified success in submarine history. Its secret, a twin propulsion system which, within a decade, would be the standard power source of every submarine in the world. Above the water, the Holland and its successors were powered by internal combustion engines, fueled with gasoline, paraffin, kerosene, and later diesel fuel. Submerged, the problem of power with no source of fresh oxygen was solved by the rechargeable battery-powered electric motor. With a suitable power source found, advance followed on advance. From its earliest inception, despite protests to the contrary, there was never doubt as to the role of the submarine. It was to be a weapon of war. This had been reinforced by the invention in 1876 of the first locomotive torpedo, self-propelled by compressed air. With its complex gyroscopic steering mechanisms, this remarkable weapon was the brainchild of English engineer Robert Whitehead. It would be the prototype of every torpedo to follow. The submarine had been given teeth. But in the years that followed, the role of the submarine in naval warfare received little attention. Naval circles were still obsessed with the glories of grand fleets. The submarine as a weapon was regarded by some as repugnant, unfair, underhanded, and by one British admiral as damned un-English. One voice, however, was raised in lone prophecy. British Admiral Sir John Fisher, architect of the modern Royal Navy in the dreadnought or battleship age, caustically observed, "It is truly astounding to me how the very best among us absolutely fail to realize the vast impending revolution in naval warfare that the submarine will accomplish." In 1914, the storm clouds of war broke, engulfing nation after nation in a global struggle for empire. The Germans moved quickest, creating a fleet of Unterseeboats, or undersea boats, later shortened to U-boats. They sank 10 million tons of shipping in 4 years. The German submarine war plan was simple. An all-out attack on the ships of the vast Allied merchant fleets. The subs would starve Britain of the means to wage war. Throughout the war, class after class of submarine was churned out from the German naval dockyards, each one better than the last. They became larger, with longer range and greater submerged endurance, equipped with bigger and more accurate torpedoes and stronger deck guns. The Germans had another vital asset, a great tradition in optics. All submarines had some kind of periscope, but the German submarine's optical equipment was superior. In 1916, one of the new submarines, the U-151 Deutschland, would twice venture into then-neutral U.S. waters, marking another advance in the evolution of Germany's lone sea raider. The world was being introduced to a formidable new weapon in sea warfare, called simply the U-boat. With no great German mercantile fleet to tackle, the Allied leaders mapped out a different submarine strategy. Their subs were to support ground forces and harass the German high seas fleet. At the core of the Allied submarine force was the exceptional British Royal Navy E-type, which, with her smaller forebear, the C-class, served valiantly in the Atlantic and the North Sea. These two subs raided aggressively in the Baltic, the Black Sea, and the treacherous Turkish Sea of Marmara. Without the submarine assault on the Turkish supply lines, the tragic Battle of Gallipoli would have been an even greater slaughter. The United States' entry into the war at sea helped the cause in two major ways. First, her submarines reinforced hard-pressed Allied squadrons. And second, her vast wealth ensured that Allied naval strength would finally break the U-boat menace. American armed convoys would eventually stop the easy German plundering of the crowded sea lanes. The tools of anti-submarine warfare were still crude. Primitive sonar, an underwater listening device called a hydrophone, and an early version of the depth charge. But the pattern of conflict had been set. Armed convoy versus submarine. In every submarine force, technological advances led to more sophisticated tactics and increasingly daring actions. But by the end of hostilities in 1918, the cost was evident. The German Navy alone had lost 178 boats, 51 officers, and 4,500 submarine forces when weighed against the appalling carnage of the land war, reinforced the immense strategic value of the submarine. Ton for ton, the most destructive weapon of the war. In the aftermath of the Great War, the response to this reality was two-faced. In public, the diplomats distanced themselves from the devil's device. But in private, every naval power was already busily fortifying its submarine strength. Germany, her fleet scuttled, and her deadly U-boats captured or scrapped, was the lone exception. The years following the First World War were full of consolidation and steady progress, but with no dramatic breakthroughs. The path was paved with eccentricity. The submarine as battle cruiser, as aircraft carrier, and as fleet escort, with the final experiments in steam. By 1935, Germany had rearmed itself. This time, it was not the Imperial Eagle which flew over the fatherland, but the Nazi swastika. Adolf Hitler was leading the German people steadily toward his war of vengeance and conquest. In Hitler's grand design, a resurrected U-boat force was to be accorded a place of importance never before given by any other country to its submarine branch. The reasons are clear. A new generation of German submarines rolled from the slipways with the understanding that Britain must be faced. Because her navy was too strong to be confronted in traditional ways, she would therefore have to be starved into submission. The weapon for the task, as in the last war, was to be the submarine. As commander of the force, Hitler made the inspired choice of Captain Karl Dönitz. An undistinguished veteran of the last submarine war, Dönitz was nonetheless a brilliant organizer who would change the whole face of submarine warfare. In September 1939, the waiting ended, and the U-boats, already at sea, struck the first blow of a sea war that would last five bitter years. Come too soon. The young force was in no way ready for its crucial task. Resigned to his fate, German naval commander-in-chief Admiral Erich Raeder could offer to his commanders only, "Gentlemen, we have no choice. Total engagement. Die with dignity." Yet allowed to choose the time and place of conflict, the submarines launched a remarkable offensive with only 57 of the 300 boats Dönitz had asked for. Quality made up for quantity. The creative drive of the German designers and the pride and resentment of the ex-submariners who had almost triumphed ensured that the U-boat production line had never ceased. The link with the tiny kerosene-driven U-1 of 30 years before remained unsevered. The legendary Type 7 class, the Das Boot subs, would bear the brunt of hostilities. Das Boot would become legendary not for its modest technical pretensions, but for the actions of its brave crews. The Type 7s, evolved from their forebears in the now familiar format, were ideal for the task. With their conning towers only 17 feet above the waterline, they were hard to see from over a mile, even in daylight. At night, and head-on, they were practically invisible. They could dive in under half a minute, down to 100 yards without strain, and 200 if hard-pressed. The Type 7's depth and endurance at high speed were twice as good as any of its contemporaries, but remained under 8 knots. After 20 years of submarine development, no combat sub had broken the 8-knot barrier. Slow underwater, but as yet unhindered by armed escorts, the U-boats hunted their quarry on the surface. The torpedo remained the submarine's main weapon. Also, the deck gun was now a feature of every submarine. Basically, the submarine was still a submersible, an underwater torpedo boat with limited submerged endurance. It needed to come up for air to charge its electric batteries. This would be its Achilles heel. The deck gun was essential. In the early days of the savage Battle of the Atlantic, U-boat crews enjoyed, in their words, happy times. Lone merchant ships scattered across the sea were easy prey. Every month, each U-boat was sending 8 Allied ships to the bottom of the sea. The Allies formed convoys, but they were ill-protected. The Allies faced a huge logistical problem. How to form armed convoys when escorts didn't exist or was spread among far-flung sea stations? In 1939, a ship's ability to fight submarines was still extremely limited. The pattern would change, but for the moment, U-boat crews enjoyed a rich harvest, returning to port to the adulation of a doting public. Their pennons, or markers, proclaimed for the world their kills, including one of the most daring raids ever. On October 13, 1939, German commander Günther Prien's U-47 slipped into the relatively safe British naval port of Scapa Flow, north of Scotland, and sank the battleship Royal Oak. For British submariners, the onset of the war was neither glamorous nor dramatic. The Royal Navy measured up to the Germans in numbers of submarines, but of its 57, few were in home waters. As the assault continued, the U-boats even laid mines, undetected, in the Thames estuary itself. From the outset, British and German tactics were diametrically opposed. While the U-boats pursued, the Royal Navy stood on station. In thin gray lines of blockade, they waited for their fast, lone prey. They were warships which had the power to strike back, and did. Soon it was difficult to tell hunter from hunted. Not until the German invasion of Norway did the Royal Navy submarines get the opportunity they craved. They eagerly took the war to the enemy. Between the 9th of April and May Day, 1940, the S and T submarines, now under the overall command of ex-submarine ace Sir Max Horton, destroyed 22 ships, including a cruiser, and crippled the German pocket battleship Lützow. The British submarines had proved the equal of Dönitz's raiders. The key to Dönitz's continuing success was in moving beyond the lone guerrilla submarine of World War I and into the dreaded wolf packs of World War II. It would take the Allies 3 years to master the wolf pack's simple but deadly tactics. The key to the whole German strategy was operations control in occupied France, where the U-boat command staff orchestrated the Wolfpack attacks. They cooperated so closely that, in a way, the command staff and the subs shared the crowded sea-swept bridges of the boats as they coursed through the Atlantic gales. A single convoy sighting by a lone U-boat would bring a radio dialogue between sea and shore, which would send submarines to converge on the unfortunate vessel. When darkness fell, the pack would surface to strike its unsuspecting quarry. They surfaced anywhere the situation demanded, even within the convoy itself, for the escorts dared not bring their guns to bear. With the U-boats presenting such a low profile against the dark of the sky, the hapless huddled convoy knew of an attack only when the first torpedoes struck. The effects were devastating. But the belligerents worked both ways. If the torpedo was the submarine's bite, it was also its betrayer, summoning escort ships to the scene with their new electronic detecting equipment and their increasing skill in determining what was and what was not a submarine. The torpedoes loosed, there was no time to celebrate victory or to dwell on a failure as, in a single moment, the hunter became the hunted and the real trial for a submarine began. To survive, a sub needed to outwit the enemy above in a tense, deadly game of hide and seek. But even if the submarine dived, once the area had been pinpointed, efficient sonar could detect the submerged marauder. A pattern of depth charges laid in a spread could end the fight or damage the sub and force it to the surface where Allied guns were waiting. Or it might be forced to dive into a silent nightmare world which tested every sinew of a submariner's stoic resolve. Being depth charged was an experience which no submarine crew wished to repeat. The psychological strain was immense as they waited for the shockwaves of an exploding charge, not knowing if this was the killing blow. As the boat shuddered, the hull leaked, and equipment was strewn the length of the submarine. But submariners learned that they could survive an attack, that the depth charge was lethal only within 30 feet. They also found out that by going deep, they could avoid the dangers of an explosion under the hull, and that the destroyer's limited number of charges would eventually run out. But there was one other great fear, chlorine gas. It was the deadly byproduct formed when leaking seawater hit damaged batteries. As the U-boats were harried and hounded, an almost tangible odor of fear mixed with the usual stench of rotting vegetables, garbage, unwashed bodies, bilge, and bile. Despite the ordeal, the submariners rarely, if ever, flinched from their task of sinking ships. To maintain the offensive, the crews needed to be in peak fighting shape and constantly at sea. The logistics of supply were bewildering. As the U-boat sweeps grew wider and the journey to safe haven on the shores of occupied France grew longer, the submarines depended more and more on the Milch cows. These converted Type 9 U-boats could refuel, rearm, and even repair a submarine at sea. The exercise bought valuable time, but was dangerous even in calm weather when they were safe from the probing eyes of the enemy, now in the sky as well as on the sea. In every theater of the war, submarines faced a new menace, which would become the greatest killer of all, the anti-submarine aircraft. For submariners, there was no more feared enemy than a sky-borne predator, appearing from nowhere, fast and lethal. An aircraft's very presence, hostile or not, made surface running exhausting and dispiriting and disrupted vital tasks. Wise commanders, without shame, dived from anything with wings. In December 1941, the Japanese surprise attack on the United States Naval Fleet at Pearl Harbor provoked the opening of the other great arena of submarine warfare in World War II, the Pacific Ocean. The hard-pressed German U-boat force had gained an ally and some respite as U.S. naval forces switched focus to this new theater. The reception by the Germans of the I-130 a typically large ocean-going Japanese submarine of World War II, signaled the flourishing spirit of cooperation between the submarine forces of Japan and the Third Reich. At the end of their historic journey, visiting Japanese were accorded a full state welcome. It was a masterpiece of propaganda. But behind the festivities, the diplomats were hard at work. Dönitz promised the Japanese new U-boats to swell their Indian Ocean force. But few of the large ocean-going Type 9 boats survived the perilous 6,000-mile journey through the South Atlantic. The Indian Ocean was virtually the only place where Japanese submarines would be allowed to employ their greatest asset, the sub's freedom of movement and surprise, hallmarks of the ultimate guerrilla. In the first months of the operations alone, the Japanese sank 20 Allied merchant ships, but the force remained a footnote as more attention was drawn to dramatic events in the Pacific. Throughout the early war, the efficient Japanese industrial machine poured out class after class of large attack submarines. They were to be the tools which would police the ever-expanding Japanese maritime empire. But the inflexibility of Admiral Yamamoto and his naval high command hampered his skilled and dedicated submarine crews. Japanese subs were models of discipline, requiring rigid adherence to orders. But they were charged with carrying out an ill-conceived strategy which tethered the submarines to the surface fleet. The Battle of Midway showed the folly of this unbending stance. In June 1942, Japanese submarines were left wallowing in the wake of the warships. From this moment on, the Japanese submarine force slipped slowly toward ultimate defeat. In stark contrast, the American Navy was now fully ready after grasping the true nature of the Pacific War. It was the reverse of the Atlantic situation, where Britain was under siege. In the Pacific, Japan was the island nation dependent on the sea for supply, and America exploited every resource to starve the enemy into submission. The whole Pacific was a war zone, and every ship on it a potential target. By late 1942, the United States' massive submarine building program hit its stride. Obsolete First World War boats gave way to fast new submarines, built to withstand long tests of endurance in the vast Pacific. The 73 submarines of the Gatto class, with their partners, the Beleo and Tench class, were the new killer fish, which would bear the brunt of hostilities in the Sea War. They were America's long-range attack submarines and would become famous in World War II. Built to cruise 10,000 miles without refueling, the 300-foot boats combined strength with endurance. Each featured 10 torpedo tubes, 3, 4, or 5-inch guns, and machine guns. The all-electric drive of 4 diesel generators allowed 20 knots while surfaced and cut down on lost running time from engine failure. Diesel-electric propulsion didn't drain the batteries like direct drive. It saved hours of recharging, which then allowed more time to drill the crews. Submariners were a breed apart, and had to be, to have the mental and physical toughness to endure month after month in the twilight world of a submarine. But they also had to have the skill, reflexes, and nerve for the moment of attack. They were taught the theory. They were taught the practice. They were taught to survive. Or at least to believe that they could survive, could escape from an underwater grave. It was so grueling that only 50% of the all-volunteer U.S. force survived the weeding out. Each session grew more intense, with drill after drill, exercise upon exercise, and the constant refrain, dive, dive, dive. Precious seconds could mean the difference between life and death. As one submarine commander put it, there is no margin of error in a submarine. You were either alive or dead. The submarines that left the American bases were superb fighting machines, manned by fit, expert, and fiercely loyal crews. They were confident that everything had been done to maximize their success in battle. The code word was endurance. More space meant more supplies and torpedoes. Air conditioning meant fewer malfunctions in the electrics as well as comfort. Water purification and daily vitamins meant a healthier, more effective crew on the long hauls at sea. Finally, complex electronics, night radar, and an effective naval intelligence system gave the crews the added tools to carry out the task to find them, chase them, sink them. But the submarine was only as good as its weapons. For an incredible 21 months, U.S. submarines fired erratic torpedoes, like the ill-tested Mark 14. One submarine, faced with the fantastic sight of three enemy carriers in periscope view, fired 10 torpedoes. Only one found the target. Besides the missed opportunities, another consequence of torpedo failure was morale. The errant firings wasted the efforts of courageous crews, who were blamed for the poor results. But American submariners in the Pacific further developed and refined the tactics learned by their predecessors in the European Sea War. They found success by adopting the salvo technique, raising their chance of a hit by firing in concert with other boats. By 1944, Japan's empire was collapsing. Her merchant fleet and her economy were being shattered. Submarines would claim 60% of the final toll, more than all other U.S. naval and air units combined. But the cost was high. One of every four subs never returned, and one of every seven submariners died. In 1944 alone, the Silent Service sank one Japanese battleship, seven aircraft carriers, two heavy cruisers, seven light cruisers, 30 destroyers, and seven submarines. They damaged numerous other vessels beyond repair. No target was too small for the hungry U.S. submarines. These losses could not be sustained. By April 1945, only four Japanese attack submarines were operational. The others had long since been sunk or converted to mules, blockade runners for the foundering Imperial Navy. The ailing Japanese submarine fleet was forced into desperate last-ditch measures, like the kamikaze-style Kaitens. These one-man suicide torpedoes were a gruesome tribute to fanatical Japanese courage and sacrifice. These last futile gestures ended 4 years of the tragic misuse of a skilled, committed, and brave Japanese force. Admiral Charles Lockwood's Asiatic Force, along with others, lost 52 of 336 submarines, but had arguably sunk the Japanese Empire. For the first time, the submarine had been a crucial component of a major strategic victory. The laurels were shared, but without the submarines, there would have been no laurels at all. By mid-1943, the long, bitter Battle of the Atlantic was turning. The Germans were losing 15 U-boats a month to the Allied hunter-killer groups. All attempts to redress the balance failed. Even with the Schnorkel breathing device, anti-aircraft guns, anti-sonar, radar decoys and coatings, and high-tech sensors, the U-boats remained vulnerable. Darkness, once a commander's friend, no longer helped. The tables of the early war had turned, and the Allies and their radar waited for the submarines to surface in the night. Dönitz told Hitler, "The enemy has new detecting gear which makes submarine warfare impossible for the first time." Hitler, Dönitz, and Munitions Minister Albert Speer all realized the war was being lost, and what Germany desperately needed was a new breed of submarine. They almost materialized. In fact, new submarines capable of outpacing the hunter-killers did exist. They were the fast, streamlined 21 and 23 U-boats, but they would never reach the fleet. With virtually the same class of submarines that had confidently begun the war, the German submariners finally lost the technology race, beaten by time. On the last day of the Atlantic War, Admiral Dönitz, successor to Hitler, gave a poignant farewell to the German submariners, one of the most dedicated forces of World War II. Out of 39,000 men, 28,000 had been killed in action and 5,000 captured. They had suffered a staggering 85% loss rate. By the 1950s, the advent of nuclear fission had at last furnished the submarine with the power source engineers had sought for more than a century. When the modern submarine submerged, it literally disappeared. Its range was limitless, and it never stopped working. Free to cruise the deep undetected, the new nuclear submarines took their undisputed place in the covert military arsenal. For four decades, it would bear the indelible stamp of the tension that was the Cold War. The irresistible march of technology, harnessed for political and military ends, had solved all the problems of undersea mobility. Science and man had created the nuclear submarine and transformed it into the absolute instrument of destruction it has become. As the delicate political maneuvering of the Cold War continued, nuclear submarines of both superpowers were constantly at sea, patrolling the depths of the oceans and the polar ice cap. Their very presence posed a serious problem in each armed camp. How to combat the threat? How to detect the undetectable? The same advanced technology which had created the weapon was harnessed to furnish the antidote. Nuclear submarines featured advanced sensor systems, anti-submarine missile aircraft, and anti-missile missiles. In the war games of the post-war decades, the Soviet Union and the U.S., with its NATO partners, tested the submarines. They pitted the powerful ballistic and cruise weapon systems of their subs against the others' submarine killers. Though simulated, and in uncontested waters, these computerized games of cat and mouse were a disturbing echo of the very real life and death contests of the great submarine battles of old. The helicopter was one answer to the invisible menace created by the submarine's almost limitless submerged endurance. By sinking sensitive sonic probes into the ocean, the helicopter could detect the same sounds and vibrations as the old hydrophones and radar systems did, only far better. In 1982, the past met the present in the South Atlantic. The actions of one Royal Navy submarine reinforced the potency of the submarine in a real war, the Battle for the Falklands. Given permission to attack, Her Majesty's nuclear-powered submarine Conqueror fired a pattern of Mark 8 torpedoes at the old Argentinian cruiser General Belgrano. Two hit the ship. The Belgrano listed to port and sank, killing 368 sailors. From that moment on, the Argentine Navy kept its larger surface ships safe in port. One submarine shifted the balance at sea to the Royal Navy. The sinking was tragic, but even more ominous was what could have happened. The Conqueror carried far more powerful weapons. Today, the weapon systems of these submarines would not even come close to the awesome armament found on any one of the world's ballistic submarines, which prowl the seas every day. Nuclear submarines, like those used in the Persian Gulf War, have changed the nature of warfare forever. At the present time, submarines exist that are capable of destroying not cruisers, but continents. The Cold War is over, but this threat remains. Will it ever become a reality?